No, thank you. I only smoke cigarettes after making love. So back in England, I'm a 20-a-day man.
I'm not a great laugher, sadly. But I might have sniggered at it, which was my way of saying that was very funny.
Remarkably, Blackadder first slithered onto our screens all of 25 years ago.
I'd mud-wrestle my own mother for a ton of cash, an amusing clock and a sack of French porn.
So tonight, we celebrate the series that sired a comic generation and a quantum of quotable lines.
You've really worked out your banter, haven't you?
No, not really. This is a different thing. It's spontaneous and it's called wit.
We travel by train, plane, boat and automobile to track down the original cast and creators who've gone on to conquer all corners of the known universe.
If you should falter, remember that Captain Darling and I are behind you.
About 35 miles behind you.
We travel from Northumberland.
When we were filming here, it was the first time I'd ever met a camp Geordie.
To northern France.
If ever there was a subject requiring of satire, it's people blindly going to war.
From Hollywood.
There were some rather large egos. I happen to be perfect, but everyone else is just a sort of big-headed twerp.
To the Horn of Africa.
After Blackadder, I sort of semi-retired, really, and I bought this small African town, Pitendwe. And the land you can see there, up until the hills, that's all mine. Behind is Christopher Biggins, except the hill further on, that's the S Club 7 and Boy's Own Accountant.
Blackadder, to remind those from another planet, followed the exploits of the devilishly cunning Edmund Blackadder and his trustily stupid sidekick, Baldric.
Baldric, believe me, eternity and the company of Beelzebub and all his hellish instruments of death will be a picnic compared to 5 minutes with me and this pencil.
Prepare journey from the mayhem of the Middle Ages through the terrible Tudors to the gorgeous Georgians.
Hurrah!
Ending up in the First World War. As an historical sitcom, it's timeless and keeps on twisting and turning its way into the public's affections like, well, a twisty-turny thing.
And your chosen subject?
Blackadder.
Blackadder, the TV series.
Blackadder goes forth.
It's even the backbone of school history lessons.
Now, who's heard of Blackadder?
I want to be remembered when I'm dead. I want books written about me. I want songs sung about me. And then hundreds of years from now, I want episodes from my life to be played out weekly at 9:30 by some great heroic actor of the age.
Now, for the first time, Blackadder himself, Rowan Atkinson, and producer John Lloyd are retracing the story of the show. A story that began at Oxford University, where a young Atkinson first met the show's fellow creator, Richard Curtis.
I did nothing of the theatrical nature in my first term at Oxford. I was just relishing the whole, you know, sort of slightly oldie worldly, you know, privileged nature of the place, and going to endless organ recitals. I was a great lover of the organ.
I met Rowan in a small room, a Don's room in some college, with people who'd answered an advertisement for the Etceteras, which was the Oxford sort of sketch writing group.
He described me as being like a cushion. Like a cushion, because I sat on the chair and said nothing.
I thought he was a stuffed toy. I mean, he didn't say anything for the first three meetings, just a curiously shaped object in the corner. And then, just when we were trying to decide what the material should be, and we'd all been handing in sketches for months, Rowan actually stood up and did two absolutely astonishing sketches.
Ainsley. Babcock. Bland.
I was an enormous admirer of Rowan Atkinson. I'd seen him at Edinburgh, where he'd been a cult performer from his earliest performances there.
Nancy Boy Potter. Nibble.
And I don't remember ever having laughed so much. I really genuinely weed myself at one point. Just a small amount, you'd be pleased to know, but I did wee myself at Rowan's schoolmaster monologue.
Nibble! Leave orifice alone.
Not the 9 o'clock news, the show that brought alternative comedy to TV, was the next step for Rowan and Richard. It was while working together on the groundbreaking sketch show that the idea for Blackadder started to take shape, and they made a pilot that's never been seen till now.
And then there's the Morris dancers, of course.
Now, look, we're not having them. Morris dancing is the most despicable, fatuous, tenth-rate entertainment I've ever seen. A load of effeminate blacksmiths waving bits of white cloth they've been wiping their noses on. It's a positive health hazard. Go away!
The thing we really didn't want to do was anything that could be, in any sense, be compared to Fawlty Towers. I remember that was almost the starting point. You know, if it's one thing it must be, that's Fawlty Towers, or anything like it. And, of course, the great inspiration, the other side of it, the thing we did want it to be quite like, was Errol Flynn's Robin Hood.
The pilot turned into the first series, featuring a Blackadder very different from the brilliant Bounder we came to know.
What a little bird.
It was a grand affair, set in the Middle Ages at the stately Alnwick Castle in Northumberland.
Well, so 25 years ago, we found ourselves coming to this town for the first time. Oh, look, there's a bit of castle. There's a sort of gate. I'm sure when we came on the recce, we thought, oh, no, this is really disappointing. It's...
Yeah. Is that it? Just that?
Yeah.
Just that gate?
Yeah, it's a bit squat. Oh, my God, there it is.
Ah, now this does ring bells.
Yes.
Although I have to say, the whole feel is an awful lot more spruce.
It's a lot. It's very trim, isn't it? It wasn't like this.
I mean, look at that grass. You know, there are lots of castles in, you know, Kent or somewhere, which just don't have this sense of openness and bleakness which Alnwick has, particularly in the snow in February.
All I can remember is thinking, look at all this stuff that would, you know, this place would have been full of people, wouldn't it? As far as the eye could see, horses and dogs and... This is where the first shot we shot begins, as you say goodbye to Baldrick.
I remember the fantastic sound of hooves
fantastic
on these
sound.
Stone,
yeah, exactly.
On the stone inside this tunnel.
Now, I remember when you were on that horse that first day, you leaned down from the horse and there was a little dewdrop hanging off the end of your nose because it was so cold, you know.
Oh, yeah.
Raindrop
yeah, yeah.
There. And then you said, what voice shall I use? Help! Help! We haven't thought about this at all.
Get out of my way!
Going on a journey, my lord?
No, I thought I'd stand here all day and talk to you.
You'll be needing someone to tend your horse, then.
What is your profession?
One, two, three. One, two, three.
I
God, a retired Morris dancer.
I found this the other day. I actually kept a diary of the few days. 12th of February, 1983. Filming has been fantastically slow and tedious. The snow comes down on the words turn over as if summoned by an incantation and in a remarkable variety of textures. Often it's as big as gravel stones, and the flagstones look like a working model of Brownian motion illness, rather.
Thanks. Okay, excellent lyrical writing.
Hard very to good. Identify.
Very well written.
Thank you thing. So much.
Rather better than the series.
On Monday, Tuesday, worried dreadfully that Roan's character was a disaster, but it seems to be gelling well.
Oh.
Yeah.
It's gelled.
Tim McInerney is brilliant, has his Tony Robinson quite splendid juices being squeezed from a rather shriveled selection of lemons.
What comes in my head first about Series 1 is freezing to death in Alnwick Castle.
I can remember on the very first day, Tim McInerney and I started to get the giggles because in the previous hour, we had been subjected to five different kinds of snow. It was everything the Northeast had to throw at us.
The hailstones are as fat as mint imperials, and it's so cold we have to wear our long johns in the bath.
Despite its quite graphic description of the difficult conditions, actually the tone is quite optimistic. I mean, you don't sound like a man about to jump off a cliff.
What used to be strong about British comedy was that people went from writing sketches to writing sitcom, and their sketch craft was carried through.
Now let's get down to business, shall we?
Business, my lord?
Yes, bored because we're looking at some of the ways we can actually make a bit of money on this job.
Some of the things that are best in Series 1 are really sketches.
There appear to be four major profit areas. Curses, pardons, relics, and selling the sexual favours of nuns.
Selling the sexual favours of nuns?
Yeah.
You mean some people actually pay for them?
Well, foreign businessmen, other nuns.
We weren't an ensemble at that time, and in a way, for me, I think, that scene was the first time that it really gelled.
Moving on to relics, we've got shrouds from Turin, wine from the wedding at Cana, splinters from the cross, and of course there's all the stuff made by Jesus in his days in the carpentry shop.
Mm-hmm.
Got pipe racks, coffee tables, coasters,
waterproof sandals, so I don't remember.
This was my one good scene in the first Blackadder series. I was so pleased I got this. Oh, I haven't finished this one yet.
It's so verbal, isn't it? Nice props. I'm not knocking them at all, but just the three of us being serious and pulling faces.
Absolutely.
I have here a true relic.
What is it?
It is a bone from the finger of our Lord. It cost me 31 pieces of silver. Baldrick, you stand amazed.
Ah!
I thought they only came in boxes of 10.
Look at you. You should be shot for that kind of acting.
No, I could have been much worse.
I remember Blackadder being lots of fun.
In the end, you were about as much use to me as a groom in the pit. And fiction with which you must be familiar, never actually having had a break.
Hello.
The Spanish Infanta didn't know she was ugly. That's the sad thing, really, about it.
Here I am, awaiting the arrival of the most beautiful, ravishing...
Hello!
Look, leave me alone, will you? I'm trying to talk to someone. While you're wittering away like a pox-ridden moorhen.
She loved Blackadder, and she... she was electrified sexually by him.
I have waited for this moment all of my life. Your nose is smaller than I expected.
For him, it was tough. He felt a huge responsibility. Kind of carrying the show.
It's extraordinary, the physical difference with Roan between the first and the second series.
Yeah.
Do your funny walk then, Adder.
Moi?
the funny Blackadder walk.
I haven't got a funny Blackadder walk. What's our sound word?
You think one's like that?
Or something Weasley.
What seems odd now is that Tony was the streetwise smart guy and Rowan was an idiot.
Incredibly dysfunctional, almost twisted person, a bit like what Mr. Bean became.
Rowan wasn't entirely relaxed in the first series, as were none of us, because we were still not quite sure what we were doing, you know. Rowan's character wasn't properly sorted out.
Oh my God, this is impossible! I can't do this!
We tried to do too much with Rowan's character in series one, because he was sort of aggressive and stupid and posh and cowardly and brave. So I think it was a sort of agglomeration of quite a few funny things that we knew Rowan could do.
But it's interesting how, you know, an amusing costume and a daft haircut, an amusing character doth not make.
Yeah.
I sat there wanting to laugh and unable to a lot of the time.
I did laugh quite a lot, but I hope desperately that I shall laugh more the next week.
What exactly is funny about this? What is funny about having that character?
Farewell, sweet England, and noble castle. First watering place in the desert of my life. Farewell, gentle gibbets, and sweet crenellations. And farewell, dearest gutters.
I remember that famous comment of yours, you know, looks like $1 million but cost £1 million. I suppose a good thing about the modern BBC is that they would never have allowed us to do this, you know, to do what we did. I mean, you know, they would never, you know, just let a few young, you know, creative people come up to Alec and
Well, no, they wouldn't, shoot. But then, on the other hand, we were very proud of it at the time we did it.
The basic fault is the script, finally.
Yes.
Because Rowan Atkinson and this chap who he writes with have written an awful lot, and it seems to me that six episodes are too much for them. There are an awful lot of half-employed scriptwriters around who could have been brought into good effect.
There was, in fact, a slightly more than half-employed scriptwriter knocking about. Ben Elton was behind the cult series of The Young Ones, and was brought in to hone the writing of the second series.
Is the sitcom written, or is it from this? I mean, not the sitcom, the drama, the comedy.
Well,
that sounds like a good idea.
I'm working on the pilot. I'm working on the pilot episode.
Just I've now had a screening cancelled, and the end is hard to get right, and I don't know how to get the special effects right. Mm.
I think we met at a script meeting for what was going to turn into Splitting Image. And I was startled to find a huge fan of Blackadder 1. These were before the days of ratings. That was always the shock. I mean, I still don't know how many people watched any episode of Blackadder. And I remember on BBC, well, I used to wander around Shepherd's Bush looking in people's windows, particularly people with basement flats, to see whether or not anyone was watching.
You were looking to see if there were any nude girls who left their
windows. I was looking to see whether or not anyone was watching Blackadder 1, because one didn't know whether or not it'd be a success or otherwise.
Well, I wondered who that kind of ginger perv was whilst Kate and I were singing the theme tune.
He lived rough. He talked rough. He wore a rough. Blackadder 2, coming soon-ish.
They would sit in different rooms, probably even in different houses, having divided the series into two halves, and they'd write three episodes each and then swap over.
And it always led you somewhere else, you know. OK, execution, head being cut off, how's he going to get out of it? Obviously, stick the head down the back of his tights. Obvious, you know, but it may not have been obvious to the person who started with the beheading.
Percy.
Well, I've got the body, my lord, and I see you've got the head.
Yes, but look, it's no good, Percy. No one's ever going to believe we've just cut it off. It's gone green.
Ben and I never wrote together, mainly because we had better things to do with our time. We were both completely obsessed by pop music. Madness, very great era for Madonna. I seem to remember endless meetings when all we talked about was which was our favourite track on True Blue. And I remember us going to see Kylie Minogue, and we were literally the only two men there. It was very early on in her career, and the entire audience was made up of 30-year-old women who watched Neighbours, and their daughters, who also watched Neighbours, and were, by the time Kylie came on, fast asleep.
However enjoyable the writing process and however well the scripts were shaping up, Ben and Richard were less than lucky, lucky, lucky to get an ominous letter from the BBC's head of comedy.
Michael Grade had come in and he looked at the ratings and it doesn't stack up. It's not good enough for the little ratings they're getting and it doesn't get enough good reviews. It's finished.
And I remember the sentence very clearly, for this season, and realistically that means for good. Very sorry about this. It's over. At which point, a combination really of John Lloyd, Rowan Atkinson, and Rowan's agent, Richard Armitage, at the time, went into overdrive.
So there was this mad weekend where Richard and Ben and I are sitting at three typewriters, desperately cutting out all the film, taking out anything that had a silly costume, anything that was at all expensive. And we went back, I went back, 2 days later, beginning of the next week, to John Howard Davis and said, here you are, these are the cheapest sitcoms on telly, and please may we have another chance.
The key element to the success of the second series, though, would be the transformation of Blackadder himself from nerdy medieval prince of series one to suave Elizabethan courtier.
The very first lesson was to pick Rowan's character, to get it exactly clear what it was he was going to do. And as Ben says, there was a whole imperious, sarcastic, posh side of Rowan, which we both loved, which we knew how to write, which came very naturally to both of us.
Tell me, young crone, is this Putney?
That it be. That it be.
Yes, it is, not that it be. You don't have to talk in that stupid voice to me. I'm not a tourist.
It's lovely to have this sort of pecking order and to place Blackadder somewhere in it, somewhere in the middle, so he can be very cynical about those above him and indeed very cynical about those below him.
Oh, very good shot, my lord.
Thank you, Warren.
Sorry, I'm late.
Oh, don't bother apologising. I'm sorry you're alive.
There's the thing about comedy in Britain. Britain's a terrible place for class, as everybody knows. You look at a sitcom, the moment the lights go up, as it were, and you think, oh, God, it's upper-class people, I don't care about them, or, oh, God, it's middle-class dentists, I don't care about them, or, oh, God, it's wacky scousers, I don't care about them. You know what I mean? Everybody seems to hate everybody else in Britain and thinks up a reason not to care about them. And one of the marvellous things about Blackadder 2 and all the subsequent Blackadders is that they're set in a very rigidly hierarchical world.
My lord, the Queen does demand your urgent presence on pain of death.
Oh, damn. The path of my life is strewn with cowpats from the devil's own satanic herd.
You've got real threat. Blackadder is going to have his head chopped off at any moment. It's perfectly possible this mad, capricious Queen really could say, this time I mean it.
I do love it when you get cross. Sometimes I think about having you executed just to see the expression on your face.
It's within court, which is a very small, bejeweled world, you know, and there are these little people in there who think they rule the world, and of course it's only me that rules the world.
What is it?
A stick.
Is it a stick, Lord Blackadder?
Yes, ma'am, but it is a very special stick, because when you throw it away, it comes back.
Well, that's no good, is it? Because when I throw things away, I don't want them to come back. You! rid of it.
Richard and Ben had created this idea, which was the Queen was like a little girl with an enormous amount of power. I think we interviewed 40 actresses. We were really beginning to get desperate.
It was probably written in a pretty two-dimensional way. And they all just were playing girls from B-dolls.
The 41st person who walked in, we were really about to shoot ourselves, was this blonde who clearly hadn't washed her hair.
Apparently, I walked in like something that had been pulled through a hedge backwards. Spot the difference.
Here was this astonishing actress who did nothing like we expected it. Every line was odd, peculiar, weirdly pitched.
I may have the body of a weak and feeble woman, but I have the heart and stomach of a concrete elephant.
Prove it!
Certainly, well.
First, I'm going to have a little drinky, and then I'm going to execute the whole bally lot of you.
Unbeknown to most people, and Miranda, in a secret corner of the BBC, where few dare to tread, there's the forgotten costumes department.
In the bowels of the building.
What have they got in its pockets?
Oh, God. This looks rather familiar. Oh. Hope several hundred moths don't fly out or anything like that.
Look at this.
Look at even the work in the... in the cuffs, all these little individual pearls, most of them still there, just bobbling away. I remember the weight.
Oof, oh, bloody hell.
Yes, but dear friend, as I remembered, and not only the dress, not only the wig, not only the ruff, but also a pomander and a mirror attached to my dress.
Do I look absolutely divine and regal and yet and at the same time very pretty and rather accessible?
You are every jolly Jack Tar's dream, Majesty.
I thought as much.
Had we not lucked out in getting Miranda, probably Blackadder 2 wouldn't have worked.
Yeah.
I think it's held together rather well. Rather better than I have.
Even though in theory I had the title role of the programme, that because there was Stephen Fry and Hugh Laurie and Tony Robinson, and there was this wonderful feeling of being able to delegate, of being almost like the man in the middle who was able to say, you know, ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Tony Robinson will now be extremely amusing.
Warwick, I would advise you to make the explanation you were about to give phenomenally good.
You said get the door.
Not good enough, you're fired.
But, my lord, I've been in your family since 1532.
So is syphilis. Now get out.
And ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Stephen Fry.
Oh, Melty, you really are a beginner. You're not even wearing a pair of comedy breasts.
Au contraire, Burger.
What on earth? You silly, silly people. To have come all the way to Indigwe with a pair of comedy breasts.
Well, down the hatch.
Mmm. I still smell the same. How fantastic.
I always felt sorry for those who came into the Blackadder to, you know, do their roles, you know, do their cameos. Some people managed it better than others.
Flash by name, flash by nature.
Come here, camera. Come here. Come here. Hello, girls. It's Rick. Happy Christmas.
Hooray!
Where have you been?
Where haven't I been? Woof!
I was surprised when they asked me, very honouring that they should ask me. I said, all right, I'll do it, as long as I get more laughs than Rowan.
So my old mate Eddie's getting hitched, eh? What's the matter? Can't stand the pace of the in-crowd?
Many actors have many facets. I could do ego, and that's about it.
Am I pleased to see you, or did I just put a canoe in my pocket? Down, boy, down!
I've got a big one. It's a big one.
But Flashheart isn't really you, is it? I mean, it's...
No, my ego.
Who is that?
I don't know, but he's in your place.
Not for long!
It really helped somebody coming in with a different style, shall we say. Which gave everybody a bit of a kick up the arse, I think.
There was a very good headbutt. I'm rather proud of that one. I headbutt him through the door. Look, I only took the part of Flashheart for the women.
Hi, Queenie. You look sexy.
He's like Errol Flynn coming in, you know, and she's obsessed.
I've got such a crush on him.
He's just bigger and louder and got more testosterone.
Still worshipping God?
Fancier tights.
Last thing I heard, he started worshipping me!
To be standing next to Rowan is quite an experience.
My fiancé, Kate?
My baby.
You see then that Rowan is also a great reactor.
And at the end of it, Rick said, did I win? Which isn't really in the spirit of the ensemble, is it?
I don't know. I have, of course, I haven't counted, but I got 3.5 rounds of applause and he didn't get one.
Hooray!
Series 2 was a brilliant success and nothing stood in the way of Series 3. Dastardly Duo moved from Elizabethan excess to the bewigged and perfumed finery of the 18th century.
Series 3, we took a big old gamble in the beginning that we ended up with such a small cast, because there'd been sort of 5 of them, hadn't there? There'd been Melchett and Nursey and Queenie and Percy and Baldric and Rowan, and then this time suddenly there was just Baldric, Rowan and Hugh.
It was the casting of Prince George alongside Blackadder and Baldric that brought new life to the show. The role went to an actor who since quickened the pulse of America.
It's a trial, John, you've no idea.
Have you learned anything about medicine? Can you remember all the stuff?
For about 20 minutes. Yeah. You know, I can hold it in my head for about 20 minutes, and I could, for about 20 minutes, I could probably do a coronary bypass operation. So if you catch me at the right hour, then by all means, have an aortic infarction at my feet, and I'll fix it. But if it's the wrong hour, you're a goner.
I have to say, it's my favourite series, Hugh, that one, and it's because of you. And I remember saying to you on the set that one day you are going to be such a world-famous actor.
Stop
it. I told you.
Stop it. I bet you say that to all the actors in Blackadder, third series.
Hugh's always very self-deprecating about it, but that's the kind of bloke he is. He always says, oh, I just shouted a lot.
I'm a gay bachelor, Blackadder. I'm a roarer, a rogerer, a gorger, and a puker. I can't marry, I'm young, I'm firm buttock time.
Froke.
Well, yes, I suppose so.
You used to get quite stressed when you were the Prince Regent.
I came pre-stressed.
Right.
There was no stress that was added. I mean, that's what I do. I don't know why. I wish I didn't. I wish I could sort of relax and enjoy things more.
But I don't. I worry about that.
Just occasionally one can say, now, come on, Hugh, is the entire idea of your misery for us to spend the next 3 hours telling you how great you are? Because whether or not that was the idea, that is the end result.
Prince George is shy and just pretends to be bluff and crass and unbelievably thick and giddy. Whilst deep down, he is a soft little marshmallowy, piglety type of creature.
But I do love the Prince Regent. I love his attempt to be better all the time. I think that's one of the things that's so likeable about him, is he's always trying to improve himself. And we know how doomed it is. I mean, that vacant, panicky look in his eye, it's bliss.
I terminated my uninterrupted categorization of the vocabulary of our post-Norman tongue.
Well, I don't know what you're talking about, but it sounds damn saucy, you lucky thing.
The classic episode of Series 3 saw the arrival of Robbie Coltrane as Dr. Johnson.
Here it is, sir.
Author of the very first English dictionary.
This book, sir, contains every word in our beloved language.
Ooh, every single one, sir?
Every single word, sir.
Well, in that case, sir, I hope you will not object if I also offer the doctor my most enthusiastic contrafibularities. Contrafibularities, sir? It is a common word down our way.
Damn!
Oh, I'm sorry, sir. I'm anaspeptic, phrasmotic, even compunctuous to have caused you such pericombobulation.
The funny thing about the dictionary episode is there are things in it which I really don't like. Robbie's wig, which doesn't fit properly. The poets.
Be quiet, sir! Can't you see we're dying?
The dream. I've suddenly realised I don't like dreams.
Baldwick, who gave you permission to turn into an Alsatian?
Oh, God, it's a dream, isn't it? It's a bloody dream.
But the fundamental idea of the plot was a brilliant moment for us.
Now, Baldwick, where's the manuscript?
You mean the big papery thing tied up with string?
Yes, Baldwick, the manuscript belonging to Dr. Johnson.
So you're asking where the big papery thing tied up with string belonging to the baity fellow in the black coat who just left is?
Yes, Baldwick, I am. And if you don't answer, then the booted bony thing with five toes on the end of my leg will soon connect sharply with a soft, dangly collection of objects in your...
I can remember Richard saying, I had a great idea. I did, you know, it took Dr. Johnson 25 years to write his dictionary. How about he finishes it, lends it to Blackadder, Baldrick puts it on the fire, Blackadder's got a weekend to rewrite the dictionary.
And what about D?
I'm quite pleased with dog.
Yes, and your definition of dog is?
Not a cat.
And I just thought that is such a beautiful conceit, and that's a lot better than writing three good knob gags, which is what I was sort of trying to do.
The dictionary episode was an appropriate highlight for a series that revelled in the richness of the English language and was never shy of a scintillating simile.
He's madder than Mad Jack McMad, the winner of last year's Mr. Madman competition.
You look as happy as a man who thought a cat had done its business on his pie, but it turned out to be an extra big blackberry.
I'm as poor as a church mouse that's just had an enormous tax bill on the very day his wife ran off with another mouse, taking all the cheese.
A burnt novel is like a burnt dog.
Oh, shut up!
The Blackadder scripts are so revered that all these years later, the team still pore over the subtleties of their trade with fellow literary luminaries, wherever they can be found.
Want to dedicate to somebody?
To Derek, please. Thank you.
I love chimes here.
Thank you very much.
You really are a national treasure, Mr. Robinson. Have you got a favourite kind of quotation?
No, I live.
We used to play the game of guessing who'd written which line, and yeah, we were invariably wrong.
Thanks.
When it actually came to the rehearsals, and this got more and more intense, I think, sort of series by series,
everyone became fantastically and in the end wonderfully greedy.
We would do no rehearsing. We would just sit round at a table just kind of arguing about the script and pulling the script to pieces. There was one where I said, I have a message, my lord, and Rowan said, that's the worst message I've ever read. And we all went, ugh. And it ended up, that's the worst message I've ever heard since...
Lord Nelson's famous signal at the Battle of the Nile. England knows Lady Hamilton is a virgin. Poke my eye out and cut off my arm if I'm wrong.
But, I mean, people fought for their patch. You know, they didn't... Nobody just sort of towed the line and stood where they were told to stand and do what they were told to do. Everyone stood up for themselves and for their characters. Let's just say it was very free.
Yes.
And creative.
But Richard wouldn't have said that.
No. No. Just read it out, I think it was Richard's. just read it out.
They would literally sit around for the entire time discussing the script. And I know we would sometimes say, but actually, if you stood up and tried to act this script out, you might find out things about it.
I hate to raise this, having worked on it for 3 hours, but do you think it's a very good joke, this Orders Hughes, since you suggested it?
This was nothing to do with me.
It was nothing to do with it.
It was up on the board. I just wrote it out.
John and Richard and Hugh and Stephen conduct themselves in a very affable way. And when they talk about Blackadder now, it all seems like it was a bit jolly, slightly sticky sometimes, but basically fine. I don't really remember it quite like that. It was hard.
Hours would pass and packets of cigarettes would be got through and huge quantities of polystyrene, hideous, muddy coffee would be drunk in an effort to try and get the scripts right.
No, hang on, there's something wrong here. Because surely, if you're ordering a cab for a Mr. Redgrave, from Arnold's Grove in that case.
Sometimes it was very tense. I remember some very difficult times when we appeared to be just sitting around for 2.5 hours bemoaning the, you know, lack of writing clarity in a particular scene and desperately trying to think how that might be reorientated to work.
Just change it to four.
If you are a young writer and you're in with your mates, and because you've known them for a long time, they're going to be able to slag you off in a way that other people probably won't now because you're becoming successful. That's going to be difficult.
I remember this, you know, like a heart attack.
That was when I felt that the analysis was getting overblown, and that we were... I remember feeling, you know, it was better. We're now kind of feeling a duty to open everything up at all times.
I thought it was Mr. Redgrave who was ordering the cab. In fact, what you're saying is that Mr. Redgrave is the person who's going to be picked up and who's on the top bell. Yes. Sorry,
That's roughly how it was when it was good. And when it wasn't so good, it wasn't really like that. It was more strained. I'm not saying that those moments were rare, because they weren't. They were quite commonplace, but there was lots of, you know, longueurs in between. People sitting with their heads in their hands.
I remember Stephen at one point just scraping his chair back. It's an enormous person, striding around the room, and he came back to the table and he just grabbed a pencil and a piece of paper and put it in front of me, and it just said,
and a cab for a Mr. Redgrave picking up from 14 Arnott's Grove, ring top bell.
On the back of the third series, Blackadder was awarded its own Christmas special, a parody of Dickens's Christmas Carol with Ebenezer Blackadder in very different form. But the fourth series would take our comic anti-heroes into a place where heroes dwell, the First World War. Writer Ben Elton and producer John Lloyd have come to the Somme to reflect on the setting for the final series.
I've always been so interested in the First World War, and yet I've never been to the cemeteries. I mean, we've all seen the footage, and I've seen many a panning shot, as we're doing now. But until you actually stand amongst tens of thousands of crosses, each with a name on it, it's really... I had a grandfather fight on either side. Did you know my German grandfather got an Iron Cross?
No.
Yes, he got an Iron Cross, which actually is buried in England, because when, as Jewish refugees, they escaped from Nazi Europe, well, escaped, got out, my granddad brought his Iron Cross with him. Yeah. And my grandma, on discovering it, was horrified. You know, here we are, German accents, Iron Cross. People might put two and two together. So she buried it in a garden in Hampstead. What we discussed back in 88 when we were writing it was not... sort of not taking easy laughs at the expense of sort of such mass heroism. And, you know, coming here today, I'm very glad we didn't.
By the time we got to Blackadder Goes Forth, we'd always said that more than anything, what we'd like to do would be to create a series that was very claustrophobic, where the five or six of us who were the performers were trapped in a space. And what better way to feel that notion of claustrophobia than in the trenches in the First World War?
Hear the words I sing. War's a horrid thing. So I sing, sing, sing. Ding-a-ling-a-ling.
Really peculiar and bold thing to try and make a comedy out of, but I think ultimately a very sympathetic and respectful one, even though the characters were absurd and moronic at times. It never sort of disrespected their courage or their sacrifice, I think.
Oh, I joined up straight away, sir. August the 4th, 1914. Oh, what a day that was. Myself and the rest of the fellows leapfrogging down to the Cambridge recruiting office and then playing tiddlywinks in the queue. We'd hammered Oxford's tiddlywinkers only the week before, and there we were, off to hammer the Bosch.
And how are all the boys now?
Oh, well, Jocko and the Badger bought it at the first Ypres, unfortunately. Quite a shock, Dad.
This awful policy of what were called the Pals Brigades, because in 1914 people joined up together, whole gangs, the pub would all march to the recruiting station, a cricket team or the Tiddlywinks team, yeah, as we said in Blackadder. And they'd all go together and they'd all be put in the same, because the idea was they'll fight together, they'll fight for each other. And of course, this industrial war didn't really have a lot of time for people to fight for each other, because people would be mown down in an instant.
Gosh, yes, I suppose I'm the only one of the Trinity Tiddlers still alive. Blummy, there's a thought, and not a jolly one.
People don't stop making jokes because somebody's killed just around the corner. In many ways, life, as people say, have actually been in fighting in real wars, life becomes very precious and pumped up.
Baldrick, what are you doing out there?
I'm carving something on this bullet, sir.
What are you carving?
I'm carving Baldrick, sir.
Why?
It's a cunning plan, actually.
Of course it is.
You see, you know they say that somewhere there's a bullet with your name on it.
Yes.
Well, I thought if I owned the bullet with my name on it, I'd never get hit by it.
One of the things that always strikes me about that last series is how isolated all the characters in it are.
You're a bit cheesed off, sir.
George, the day this war began, I was cheesed off. Within 10 minutes of you turning up, I'd finished the cheese and moved on to the coffee and cigars.
The world weariness of Blackadder was something kind of extraordinary. It was something kind of beaten down. He was not necessarily going to win all the time. And knew that he wasn't, which gave it a kind of darker edge, I thought.
Baldrick finds his absolute apotheosis as the Tommy. You know, he can make the best of everything. He can turn things to his advantage, however
ghastly it is, he can find a better puddle to go to.
I believe that Baldrick is the key to Blackadder and the key to why it's popular. Because he's the common man. We actually all identify with this poor downtrodden guy who's not respected by anybody. And even when he's supposed to be stupid, Baldrick's analysis of everything is simple but basically truthful.
Are you looking forward to the big push?
No, sir, I'm absolutely terrified.
The healthy humour of the honest Tommy.
I had the privilege of performing a part that represented the ordinary lives of the grandfathers of an awful lot of people in the country in which I live. But really, it was for them to imbue Baldrick with that notion rather than me. I was just a bloke who couldn't make coffee.
Baldrick, fix us some coffee, will you? And try to make it taste slightly less like mud this time.
Not easy, I'm afraid, Captain.
Why is this?
Because it is mud.
In the original script, Ben had just written this line about Baldrick saying that he'd made the coffee out of mud.
We ran out of coffee 13 months ago.
So every time I've drunk your coffee since, I have in fact been drinking hot mud.
And then in rehearsals, as was so often the case, someone said, well, shouldn't there be milk in the coffee?
Well, saliva.
And then there should be sugar.
Which is?
Dandruff.
And then I know this was Tim McInerney. Very late in the week, he suddenly said, just for us, not because he thought it would go in the script, of course, we could always make it cappuccino.
Here you are, sir.
Ah, cappuccino. Have you got any of that, any of that brown stuff you sprinkle on the top?
Well, I'm sure I could...
No!
In the initial rehearsals, he wasn't even called Darling. He was called Captain Cartwright, which is kind of dull. I mean, I didn't really know who he was and couldn't get an angle on him.
And I had this bizarre idea, really, that maybe there was something laughable about him that was teasable. And then it occurred to me, maybe a name, a really silly name.
What's going on, Darling?
And suddenly, this character was born out of nowhere just because of the name.
You never mentioned this to me, sir.
Well, we have to have some secrets, don't we, darling?
I mean, it's such a simple joke, calling someone darling, especially if he's such a bitter, nasty man. They call him darling. The way that Stephen could come out, oh, darling, get a laugh every single time.
Captain Darling? Funny name for a guy, isn't it? Last person I called darling was pregnant 20 seconds later.
And every time his name is mentioned, it's just like a knife in his heart, twisting him round, and his hatred and self-loathing and his self-denial is just getting more and more tortured.
Just doing my job, Blackadder. Obeying orders. And, of course, having enormous fun into the bargain.
I mean, Darling and Blackadder are kind of the same, really. They're kind of lower middle class, you know, sort of semi-gentleman, but obviously, you know, one of them's managed to connive himself onto the staff and the other one's, you know, bad-lucked into the trenches.
You're a damn fine chap, not a pin-pushing, desk-sucking blotter-jotter like Darling here. Hey, Darling?
No, sir.
Oh, you're always so good at this. Oh, yes. Oddly enough, these feet are not the same feet that I used to play General Melchett in Blackadder. Those were my earlier feet. I lost those two feet, in a card game to Keith Allen in 1992. So these are my second pair of feet.
Young people playing old people is very funny. Because I was in my 20s and I was playing a general, it was somehow funnier than if I'd been the right age to be a general, which I now am.
And it had to be a 30-year-old playing a 6-year-old. If it had been a 6-year-old actor, it would have been different. And it wouldn't have been... It might have been funny, but in a different way. It wouldn't have worked the way Melchett worked.
It's the sort of... It's the authority of youth.
Slightly red cheeks, I remember having, because he was constantly puffing and blowing and... Ah, constantly, I... Ah,
had in my head that he had piles, so that when I sat down...
Oh!
Ah, ow! Like that. All the time, this strange noises and bleats and bars and things. It's an extraordinary gift to play a character who isn't afraid of no one, who is in supreme command.
It was just a wonderfully sort of... He was seamless. There was this feeling of a... of an unstoppable train of a performance.
Who is the judge, by the way? I'm dead.
Come on, then, come on. Get this over in 5 minutes. We can have a spot of lunch. The court is now in session. General Sir Anthony Cecil Hogmanay Melchett in the chair.
And I remember about 5 or 6 years after Blackadder 4, I was walking along the street and somebody shouted at me, "You bastard pigging murderer!" And I thought, oh, God, it's a loony. So I quickened my step. Then I heard footsteps hurrying after me. I said, okay, Mr. Fry, Mr. Fry. And I went, yes. He said, sorry, sorry, you seem very upset. And I said, well, you called me a bastard pigging murderer. He said, no, no, I said Flanders pigeon murderer.
The case before us is that of the Crown versus Captain Edmund Blackadder, the Flanders pigeon murderer. Oh, Clark, hand me the black cap, shall you? I've been needing that.
I love a fair trial.
For all the comedy bawling and bleating, the final episode saw events take an extraordinary turn as Captain Blackadder and his troops braced themselves for the inevitable.
Don't forget your stick, Lytton.
Rather, sir. Wouldn't want to face a machine gun without this.
I just remember feeling, the impending doom for my character. I remember feeling this strange sort of knot in the pit of my stomach. And it was the first time, as an actor, that I had felt the predicament of my character. I was going to die at the end of the week.
It was much more like a serious play or a drama. As all the comedy kind of melts and fades out of it and becomes sadder and sadder and more tragic and eventually almost unbearably moving and sad. It's valedictory.
I hope no one was left in any doubt of the respect I think everybody on the team had for the sacrifices made and the honour of the people involved. But it was a damn silly war. And if ever there was a subject, requiring of satire, it's people, no matter how honourably and no matter how nobly, blindly going to war.
Company, one pace forward. On the signal, company will advance.
Good luck, everyone.
In those days, you had to get out of the studio by 10 o'clock. If you didn't, the electricians would pull the switch. At 10 to 10, we finished filming in our normal studio. We then had to race across to the other studio, and it was then that we saw this No Man's Land set for the first time, and it looked dreadful.
Okay, well, this apparently is the original footage from the very last scene of Blackadder 4 where they all go over the top. And I haven't seen this since 1989. They're only actually running, 15 yards before they hit the barbed wire, and then they all stand around looking like lemons and then pretend to die, and it's very embarrassing.
Pretty unconvincing, isn't it?
Now they've done a close-up here